Good afternoon, ladies and gents. My name is Mrs. Silje, and today we're going to look at the Grade 10 formal test preparation. I just want you to take notice because of the fact that some Grade 10s are going to the school every second day or sometimes only every second week, the approach of your teacher may be a little bit different, but we are all working according to the ATPs, and depending on the low road, the medium road, or the high road that your teacher took, you will be assessed according to the ATPs. Okay, that is what we are going to use today, the ATPs, and hopefully it helps you, especially after the big jump from grade 9 to grade 10. Some of you may feel a little bit confused or stressed, so hopefully after today it will be better. Okay, so let's have a look. We are starting here today with grade 10. Term 2, formal test preparation. And before we look at the test and the content itself, I just want to explain to you how it works here with life sciences, because maybe you are not as familiar as you should be. Okay, so first of all, what we're going to look at is this whole term. Term 1, we are finished now. Term 2, you were supposed to do the assignment. The assignment for many of you may be finished already. It was 50 marks and it's going to count 20% towards your year mark. Then today we're going to look at the test. The test counts 50 mark, again 20% towards your year mark. And then just this is the interesting section for you. How are they going to calculate your term mark? And that is how they're going to do it. 25% for your assignment and 75% from this test that we are going to look at today. All right, now, how will this test look? The format of the test. Now, for grade 10, 11, and 12, this is the format. And as you can see here at the side, we have the test and the exam format. So, for section A, there's two main sections in your life sciences test or exam. Section A will be the shorter questions. Now you will know the format that we use, the multiple choice questions. That is what the MCQ represents, multiple choice questions, terminology. Sometimes that's very difficult for you. And then the column statement, where they will say what in column A fits column B, where you have to say A only, B only, none, or A and B both. Okay, so we will look at that a little bit as well. So for the test, this is going to count 20 marks. Your section B will be a little bit longer questions. There they say a variety of question types. Here we can have diagrams, and then they ask you to label the diagrams. They always start with the easier questions at first, and then it becomes more difficult to test you. So we can have the diagrams, we can have case studies where you have to answer questions, you can have a graph, or even sometimes they can ask you to draw a graph. So in this section, we will have two questions, question 2 and 3. So that will also count 50 marks in total, but 15 for question 2 and 15 for question 3 in the formal test. All right, that is now the mark allocation that you can expect. And then obviously for the finals, the mark allocation will be more, although the skeleton of the paper will be exactly the same. Okay, just something I want to clarify for you. Maybe it gives you hope, maybe it doesn't. But when the teachers set your papers, they have to apply this weighting structures that we have here. So we divided, you don't have to know all of these things. I just want to show you this one. Easy for the average learners, the 30%. It means that if you now try your best, it is possible for you to pass, because we ask the questions in such a way that you can get 30%. So if you put in a little bit extra, as you put in more, you will get the other percentages that you work for. So don't lose faith, try your best, and just make a start. Sit on the chair and start studying. You will be able to pass this subject. Okay. Now, how long will you have for this test? Depending on the test itself, there's 50 marks, and we normally say 50 minutes. But if your teachers set a test where there's longer sections to read maybe, then they can make it a little bit longer for you to be able to finish the test. Okay, 50 marks, 50 minutes. Okay, now another set of information for you so that you can see what this test will be about. We are busy with term two. That was the assignment, and this is the test. We are writing about everything that you did for from week one until week nine. And here's the information. Your teacher will have this, an ATP. Hopefully they were able to give you an example of this as well. And it shows you all the things. It's like a guideline. It shows you exactly what they can ask you about and then what you must know. Now, ladies and gents, this is like the basic. This is the least you can study. If you summarize this, then we will unfortunately have to summarize your marks. But this is what you need to know. This is according to this that I'm going to, the ATPs I'm going to use to explain to you. And yes, there's a lot more information. I'm just doing the basics. I'm trying to give you shortcuts. I'm trying to give you tips so at least you will be motivated. But the more you put into this, the more you will get out of this, obviously. Okay, so if you need this ATP, you don't have it, just ask your teacher. I'm sure your teacher will help you with this. And this is a guide. It shows you, and you can also use this to check yourself if you have studied everything that is necessary. All right, so yes, here we go. This is the start. We start with tissues, obviously, and animal tissue is the first one. Now, before we can look at animal tissue, ladies and gents, you just need to know what is the definition for tissue. When we talk about tissue, what it is. Now, you have looked at the cell. You have looked at the cell in the primary school already. So this will not be a new concept to you. So we are looking at tissue today. Now, we have different types of tissue. We have animal tissue and we have plant tissue that we're going to look at today. But first of all, this is a definition that you must study. What is tissue? And there I showed you. I want to see these words. It is similar cells that's adapted or changed for a particular function. So, tissues, it's like when you dress for a sports game. You are not going to go there in your high heels or in your tux. You must be prepared for what you are doing, for your function. So the tissue works the same. They look a specific way because they work in a specific way. They have a specific function. So please make sure that you know this definition. All right. We have cells and then it forms tissue. Tissue with the same function, they form organs, and then the organs can form a system, as we can see in this girl's body. All right, tissue is the first one. And the next term that is very important, cell differentiation. Now, when we look at the word differentiation, we see the word different. Now, when something is different, it means it looks exceptional. It doesn't look the same as something else. You are specialized. You have a specific function. Now, cellular differentiation is when this simple cell that we had in the beginning changes into something more specialized. It's like when you are finishing with school, maybe you go and you study at a university, so you are now going to specialize in a specific section, a topic, a degree, and you will know everything that you need to know regarding that section of the work. So cell differentiation shows us that we start with a basic cell here in the beginning. Here I have a picture of stem cells. Now, stem cells are cells that is undifferentiated because they don't know what they are going to become. They can actually become, here we show you intestinal cells that you get in your intestines. There's cardiac cells of cardiac muscles. Cardiac, always when you see this word cardiac, it has to do with the heart. Here we have red blood cells that's carrying the oxygen in your body. And here we have nerve cells. They look a lot different. The nerve cells are carrying the messages or as we will say, the impulses to your brain so that you can make decisions and you can do things. There we have the normal muscle cells that's contracting or relaxing so that you can move or play sport. And there we have liver cells. Now, when you look at all these different cells, they don't look the same. But when they started off, they all look the same in the beginning. So that is what cell differentiation means. It starts simple, it starts basic, and then it becomes more specialized as it develops, as it divides. All right, cell differentiation. Next topic, animal tissues. Now, normally when we do this with the learners, they all start to sigh and cry and become depressed. But I've tried to make a summary for you about all the tissue that you need to know about. Yes, there's a lot more information about this, but if you can just get this mind map in your mind, then at least it will help you a little bit. All right, so there's four main animal tissue types that I want you to remember. The first one is epithelial. You can see it's a specific color. Connective tissue. Now, when you hear the word connect, you must all know how to connect with your cell phones. So it's between things that we are bringing things together. Muscle. Some of you guys will be flexing muscles in front of the mirror daily and showing everybody how you can pump your muscles. And then nerves. The only nerves you know about at this stage is when you get on your own nerves or your parents. So they will tell you, but the nerve tissue works a little bit differently. So the four main types that please you have to study is epithelial, connective, muscle, and nerve tissue. All right, that's the beginning. Now, let's just look at the first one, epithelial tissue. Now, epithelial are tissue that we normally get on the outside of structures, okay? Now, if you quickly just look at all four of them, you will see, yeah, the shapes may be a little bit different, but all of them, they have this basic circle structure in the middle, and it's prominent. You can immediately see it. And then another thing that I see, it's like more or less a square, or here they look a little bit like columns. So at least there's something that's the same when we look at them. Now, epithelial tissue, like I said, you must study. It's tissue that's covering. It's covering sections of your body. It can be on the outside, your skin. It can be on the inside of your intestines. So all of these cells, they are covering a specific area, and they are all part of the family that's called epithelial cells. Now, when we look at this first one, squamous tissue that we talk about, that would be like scales. It's sort of like a roof tiles or a fish. It looks like scales that's connecting with one another. Now, the moment you see scales, you must think squamous. Okay, and yeah, I added a little bit allows for diffusion. All of them will obviously have a function. The next one, cuboidal, means cubes. The Rubik's cube that you most probably will be playing with. It is cubes, it's blocks. And the moment you see it's blocks, then it's cuboidal epithelial. It's like the name and the surname. Okay, this one is for secretion. Secretion is when certain things are given off, distributed in the body. Absorption is when you're taking something in. Next one, columnar. It looks like columns. Look there. It looks like columns where we have gates or we have fences. All right. And there we have the nuclei at the bottom. All of them are columns. Columnar, epithelial. And they are for protection. They are protecting something. They like a gate. They like a fence. The last one, ciliated, we refer to that word that means cilia. Cilia means hair. Now, I don't know if you can see so clearly there on your screen, but there's little hairs there everywhere on top of these column-like structures. Okay, now, the moment we see hairs, I want you to think about things going like this, moving like this, ne? So they are going to help with movement, maybe moving certain particles. And then another thing that they are doing, they are helping to increase the surface area. So these four cells, they are all part of the family of epithelial cells. And you can get a picture like this. Your teacher can give you the picture and ask you to identify which type of tissue is this. Maybe first they will ask you, is it animal or plant tissue? And then you can say animal tissue. And then they can ask you if it's epithelial, connective tissue, or nerve tissue, and you can say epithelial. And then we have the four types. All right, so make sure you understand what this is all about. That is the outside epithelial. Now we're going into the body a little bit. So now we have to look at the cells that's connecting certain parts. It binds, it's connective. So remember, when you remember the word connective tissue, the function is there already inside. It's connecting certain things with one another. All right, now connective tissue, again, we have more than one type. We have blood tissue, cartilage, tendons, ligaments, and bones. Now, when you look at all of these, this one is the most familiar because it looks like rings of a tree. So your bones is almost like the tree. And when you cut through a tree moss, you can see the different rings that tells us how old the tree is. Now, I wonder, let's see if we cut through a bone, if we can see the rings, how old you are. Of course not. It's just a joke, but it looks like that. So immediately if you see any structure like this with lots of rings, when it reminds you of a tree trunk, then that is bone tissue. Okay, your bones are looking like this underneath the microscope. When you study histology one day, you will see that. Okay, now tendons and ligaments. Do you see that this one and this one and that one is printed in bold? They are important because we're going to talk about them again. Blood, when we look at the heart, tendons and ligaments, when we look at the skeleton. So pay special attention to them. Okay, so blood tissue, when you look at all of them, blood tissue is the only one that is like a liquid. It's flowing, it's moving. And then inside blood tissue, we have different types of cells. You will know it by now. Red blood cells, white blood cells, and we have plasma. So that's why they look different. There's different structures inside the blood, okay? But blood is connective tissue. Then cartilage, okay? Cartilage, they look different. They have spaces in between, and then they have these cells. Tendons, it looks like muscle tissue. It's not muscle, but it looks like muscle tissue. All of these lines. Ligaments, it's the same type of tissue. It doesn't have those cells. But there they are. Now, many times when you play sport, they would have said, oh, okay, no, you tore your ligaments and you can't play sport now for 6 weeks and so on. And you have to use rest, ice, compression, and elevation. So you injure your ligaments, and ligaments are the structures that's connecting what? It's connecting your bones to one another. And then the tendons are connecting the muscle to the bone. They are like ropes. Here we have like rope of collagen. They are connecting the muscle and the bone. And the cartilage are those tissue that we get in between the bones. So sometimes when you struggle, you hear your parents struggle with their hips or their knees, then there can be problems with the cartilage in between. Sometimes the bones started to degrade because they are older already. Okay, so this is the connective tissue, putting everything together. Here we looked at the outside. Now we're going inside. We're looking at what is connecting your skeleton. So that is the connective tissue. We're bringing everything together. All right. The next one is the muscle. So this connection cannot work if we don't have the muscle that can now pull everything together, that makes you walk, that makes your heart beat, etc. So the muscle tissue, they must contract. They must contract and relax. So they must be strong. And they can't get tired. They must keep on working the whole time. So we have three types of muscle tissue. Skeletal tissue, smooth muscle tissue, and cardiac muscle tissue. Now this one is the easier one to remember because your heart, it's a muscle, it's pumping the whole time. And very, very important, this word, involuntary. It means it's happening on its own. You are not sitting there every day saying, okay, my heart, now you must pump blood. It's happening on its own. The same with the smooth muscles. They have other functions in your body. So they are doing this. They're just doing their job every day without you telling them to do it. And you can see it's also like these rope-like elongated, longer structures. This is the diagram, and that is the real McCoy. That is how it will look underneath a microscope. Cardiac tissue that you get in your heart, smooth muscle tissue, and then skeletal tissue. They are voluntary. You have to make them work. In other words, that is now your brother that's flexing in front of the mirror the whole time. He's now contracting the muscles so that he can look bigger and impressive. Okay, so voluntary is when you have to make it work yourself, muscle tissue. Now, lastly, the nerve tissue that we have here. Now, nerve tissue, they are very, very important to us because they bring the messages to your brain, and then the messages will go back to your body to do the work. Now, normally, yes, we say messages in the beginning, but that will be changed. The message that your body received, your brain cannot read the language when it's a message. It must be an impulse. So your brain can only read the message when it's an impulse. Okay, so we have three types of nerve tissue: the sensory, the motor, and the interneuron. So when you look at the words already, you can guess, I'm sure. Sensory neuron will be, it's coming from your senses. You will find this. It will tell you, what are you seeing? What are you hearing? What are you tasting? What are you feeling? All of those messages will go to your body and tell you now, okay, this is what you are eating. This is what you are feeling. The wind is cold. You have to put on a sweater. That is the sensory. They are mostly in your skin. And then it gives you the information that you have to react upon. Then it goes to your spinal cord, to your brain, and the motor neuron. This one looks like a little man to me. I always say it's like a Rasta man with long hair. There we have it. The little one that looks like a man is called a motor neuron. The word man and the word motor starts with the same word. So maybe that will help you to remember. This is the motor neuron. Okay. You will also see that sensory, motor, and interneuron, it's printed in bold because it becomes very important in grade 12. So just have a look again. Yes, it's all important. They can ask you about it. But those printed in bold, those are the ones that you're going to take forward, that you're going to take with you. Okay, so the interneuron is in between. So the interneuron, always sometimes called as the connector neuron, it's connecting the motor neuron and the sensory neuron with you. Or with one another in you. Okay, so the sensory neuron gets the information. It quickly goes through your spine to the brain. The brain makes a decision, and then when it sends the impulse back, the motor neuron will do the work. If you're touching something that's hot, your arm will pull away quickly so that you don't injure yourself. Okay, so ladies and gents, this is the animal tissue in short. Like I said, this is basic. This is really not all the information. If you find it interesting, you can really go and add stuff here. But you must have a mind map. You need to know where you're going and what you are studying. And hopefully this helps. Okay, so this is animal tissue. The next one, plants. Now, the moment I say plants, half of you start crying. Okay, you don't like plants. You will eat plants, yes, but you don't want to study about plants. All right. Now, what I try to show you here again is a mind map to make it easier. We are going to look at plants. And plant tissue is divided in two main groups, not four like the other one, two main ones. Meristematic and permanent. Now, you know what permanent is. It's finished. It's mature. It's already, it has a function. It's already finished. But meristematic tissue is growing tissue, actively dividing tissue. And here you see that word again, not differentiated. Okay, so it's growing the whole time, making this plant growing taller or making the roots growing deeper into the soil so that the plant can get more water and nutrients. Now, let's look at the meristematic tissue first. Let me just show you this. All right. Now, like I said, meristematic, you must study that word. It means not differentiated. It's actively dividing, cell division, okay? Now we get two types. We have apical meristem, lateral meristem. Now, when you look at that A, I always say that A makes me think of Christmas, okay? The Christmas tree with all the presents underneath. So when apical or apex, it means the top. So when I ask you, where is the apical meristem, where will we find that? It means we will find it here in the tip of the stem. So these actively dividing cells we find in the tip of the stem, because the stem is most now growing. It's growing towards the light. Né? And then here at the bottom, we see the tip of the roots. The tip of the roots, they are also growing. So they also have apical meristem. And that is primary growth. It's the beginning. You start at primary school. So primary growth is the beginning where we have growth upwards and downwards. Upwards from the stem, downwards from the roots. Because you must still remember roots and stems from previously. All right? Now lateral, when I look at that L, it shows me it goes sideways. So lateral growth will be in the stem itself, like a tree trunk that's growing bigger and bigger and bigger each year. Okay? So that is lateral. We call it secondary growth. So now this stem is becoming wider and stronger and harder. Okay? So meristematic tissue, we have apical and lateral, and that's it. That's all you need for that section. All right? Very important. These three pictures you would have seen already. And I want you to get your mind map sorted, because the tissue that you see here, that we find in the leaf. When I take the leaf, when the leaf is lying like this, and I turn it sideways, and we look at the leaf sideways, that specific section that you see there, that is how the leaf looks. So actually, if I draw this, this is just the middle section of the leaf that we're looking at now. All right? Then this one is the stem. When I cut through the stem there and I look at the stem, this is how the stem will look. Obviously, you will not see all of this immediately when you go and do it now. You will need a microscope to see this. All right? And then here we have the root. Now, maybe you can see it a little bit, but not a lot. There's root hairs. And the moment you see this in a structure, you know that this must be the root that they are talking about. So the big difference, just quickly, the big difference between the stem and the root is that you can see there's root here. And then obviously you can see what is happening here inside is different. So some people say the root tissue, it looks as if it's a cross. Other people say it's like X shape. Doesn't matter, as long as you can remember, the root looks like this. Okay, so please remember, we're going to look at the different tissue types. It's very important. That's why I put all of it together for you here. They have different colors because it's different parts. But the leaf looks like that inside. The stem looks like that. And this last one is the root that we have here with all the root hairs. All right. Now, when this plant has grown now, or it's growing the whole time anyway, but in the meantime, those structures that we have inside, those the tissue with their specific functions, let's have a look at them. The permanent tissue, the mature tissue, they have a job. They like your parents. They are not playing around anymore. They have a job, né? A permanent, a specific function. So all of these cells that you see here, they are specialized. They are differentiated. You remember what it is? Going from simple cell to a cell that is specialized, that has a specific job. Okay, and here they are. These are the ones that you need to know for grade 10 life sciences. Permanent tissue is made up of the yellow ones, the green one, the red ones, and then the two that I have here. So let's look at the first one, epidermis. Epidermis is on the outside of the leaf, the top part of the leaf. This is the top part. We call that the dorsal side. And this is the underneath the leaf. That is the ventral side. Okay, so this is the top part. This is under the leaf. Okay, so we have epidermis there and epidermis there. Then when you look at the stem, there we also have a yellow section. All around we have epidermis. That's the outside section. That's the first line of defense. Okay, you have a blue line here and you have a blue line there. That's the cuticle. We will talk about that now. And then here underneath the ground, you see the first layer is epidermis. So the moment we talk about what is on the outside first, it's the epidermis, these cells. Now, the stomata we will find in the leaves. they will be in the leaves. We'll talk about them now. The root hair will obviously be in the root. Okay, so let's have a look. Different sections. Epidermis. On top of the epidermis, there's a cuticle. We're going to look at that. And remember, for permanent tissue, for them, they all have a function. They're all important. Okay? We will look at the different parts now more closely as we go to the different sections. But while we have our map here, have a look. The epidermis is on the outside. The epidermis is translucent. It will let the light come through because in general, what is the function of the plant? Photosynthesis. It must make food for the plant, and then, halala, it gives us oxygen that we need. So the light rays, the energy of the sun must be able to come through the epidermis into the leaf and into the stem. All right, here underneath, we don't have sun, but there's still epidermal tissue. Okay, and through the epidermal tissue and through the root hair, the water and the nutrients will come. All right. Then stomata. You see there's a little opening there. Now stomata, they are stoma is one, or stoma is one. Stomata, it's many. Here you can only see one little opening, and that opening is for water, vapor to come out of the plant if there's too much water inside of the plant, or for gas to come in. Remember, CO2 must come into the plant. And then it comes in through the stomata. So the stomata is important for gas exchange and for transpiration. That's the function. Root hair, here at the bottom, like I said now, it needs to get the water and the nutrients from the soil. So all the outside structures or cells, they have specific functions. That's why they are differentiated. Okay. Now parenchyma, the next type of cell that we have here is the green ones. Okay, parenchyma, there's many, more than one function. We have different types of parenchyma, and we have here the palisade mesophyll. You can see they look like palisades. Palisade, some people put a palisade fence around their house, and it's these long structures. They look just like that. And then this is the spongy mesophyll. They look like the holes that you're going to see in a sponge. All right. Now, that's the green sections that we see here. That's the parenchyma cell. Now, the parenchyma cells, as you see, it's green. They have chlorophyll. You can see they are green here. So they have to do with photosynthesis. And then they're going to have to do here, where we see lots of spaces, gas exchange. That is why I made parenchyma green. And then some of the cells, they're going to store food for the plant. Okay, now the next two, the red ones, when you look at the red here and the red here and the red there, they are to give, they give strength, okay? So the first one, colenchyma, it starts with a C because the corners of these cells are thickened. You can't see it yet. When you go and you have a look in your book, you will see that. And when something is thick, it's strong and it can protect. Sclerenchyma is harder. We get sometimes this form, it becomes hard. It forms those stones that you get in fruits, the pitta. So that is the very, very strong tissue, sclerenchyma. So both of them, they are giving strength and a firmness, structure to this plant. So when this plant is now swaying in the wind, just to make sure that it can stay flexible, that it can move, that it won't just break off. So those things are giving structure. Those cells, types of cells, are giving structure. We have them in the leaf, in the stem, and in the root. Okay, now the last two cells here. We now have the outside, we have the strength and structure and other functions. So now this plant must get water and food and CO2 and nutrients. And these two types of specialized cells, xylem and phloem, they are what we call conducting tissue. They are conducting, they are moving something, and they are mostly vascular tissue. They are in the vascular bundles that we see here. So first of all, in the leaf, you will find it here in the middle, okay? That section there, the purple, more purple color, that's the xylem tissue. Here we have the phloem, all right? And the same here in these bundles that we have here. The purple section is xylem. The blue section is phloem. And the same here, the cross or the X, that's xylem, and the blue is phloem. Okay, now the big, big function of xylem is to bring the water and the nutrients from the roots up in the plants to all parts of the plant. So also when you look at the structure, okay, yeah, it's too small for you to see, but it looks like it circles. It's like a straw structure, like a column, like a pipeline, because it's bringing the water and the nutrients from the root. And then this other one is a little bit smaller. That's the phloem. It's just moving inside the plant to provide the plant with glucose, with food. And that is why this one is important. All right, so this is the plant tissue in general. Get your GPS working so that your map, you know what is happening. This is the least you can know. All right, those difficult words, if you struggle to spell this, you must just keep on spelling it. Write it out 10 times until you can spell this. Luckily, parenchyma, colenchyma, sclerenchyma, they all the same chyma. Okay, the word is the same. This is plant tissue. Now we're going to look at the different sections. I hope you are still with me. Remember, ladies and gents, that you can pause this. And when you have strength again, you can come back. Or maybe when you have something to drink or to eat, then you can come back again. Okay, just quickly, this is how a leaf looks, in case you didn't know. You don't have to know all of these words before you start crying again. But I just want to mention a few. Okay, that point, apex, remember I told you about the Christmas tree. Apex, the point there at the top, apical, all right? Then you see they talk about margins. It's these faint veins that you can see here. And that whole section is called the blade or sometimes the lamella. And if this surface area is large, the larger the surface area, the more sunlight can go into the leaf so that photosynthesis can take place. So it's all about why is the leaf built like this? It's built like this for its function. We want the leaf structure to be large because this plant wants to photosynthesize and to lose water. The smaller the leaf, the less water will be lost. Okay, sometimes the leaves curl up so that they don't lose water. All right, here in the middle, that vein, that main section that we see there, we call it the midrib or the main vein, the base there at the bottom. Petiole, that is the stalk that attaches the leaf to the plant. Okay, now when we take that leaf and we look at the leaf, this is very, very important, ladies and gents. You would have done an activity looking like this, maybe not in color, but it's very, very important that you know the different parts. Okay, so there on the outside, the blue part is the cuticle, the waxy layer. Now that waxy layer, we will look at the function now. That's the epidermis. It's translucent because it needs to let sun come through. That is the palisade mesophyll. They look like palisades. They have a specific structure because they're supposed to channel the light like a tube downwards into the plant so that photosynthesis can take place in the chloroplast. Those things that you are seeing there, they are chloroplast and they contain chlorophyll. Okay? The spongy mesophyll cells that you have here, they have intercellular spaces for gas exchange. They have thin cell walls so that the gas can move through and then obviously the light as well. There at the bottom of the leaf, remember now this is underneath the leaves, we have stomata. The stomata helps with transpiration and gas exchange. They have guard cells that we will look at now. The guard cells swell up and then it closes the gate. Then nothing can go in or come out. Just have a look here. Here we have the brown color cells. You see that? They are supposed to give strength and structure. There we have the xylem, there we have the phloem. So we have bigger sections, smaller sections. Also, some parts of the xylem cells, they have lignin that helps to make it strong because it needs to have support. Okay, there's the phloem cells. Let's carry on. Next one. All right, still the same thing. just a different version in case you get a picture that looks different. We're still busy with the leaf. And now here we have stomata at the top and there we have stomata at the bottom. Yes, that can happen. The more stomata a plant has, the more gas exchange and transpiration can take place. All right. So there, instead of just having one section, now we have more. Again, xylem and phloem and phloem. But the rest still looks the same. The cuticle, the waxy cuticle on the outside, preventing water or water vapor from escaping so that the plant can keep the water inside and then sunlight can come through the upper epidermis. Obviously, we have lower epidermis here as well. And then we have the palisade mesophyll cells, the longer cells. And here we have, again, the spongy mesophyll cells with the spaces in between so that gas exchange can take place. And there again, we have the stoma. So the functions, they stay the same the whole time, all right? Xylem and phloem, stoma, epidermis, cuticle, mesophyll. Make sure you remember the labels. And then I want you to have a look here, the stoma. That section that we see there inside the leaf, we are now going inside the leaf, né? In the epidermis at the top and in the epidermis at the bottom. This is the stoma. Stoma because it's one, stomata when there's a lot. Now, the cell has an opening in the middle and here we have two cells on the side of the stoma. These two cells, they are like two soldiers standing at the gate. They are like guards. So that's why we call them guard cells. Okay, they guard the opening. Now, when they are swollen like this, you see what happens? This vacuole is filled with something. Yeah, they are not open. They are closed. Okay, when the stoma is open like this, when they are swollen, they are open so gas exchange can happen. When they are flaccid or shrunken like this, you can see the vacuole is now smaller than there, obviously. Okay, so this one is filled with contents, this one is without contents. And have a look, it's just still a normal cell. We have a nucleus, we have a vacuole, there's a cell wall because there's a plant and a cell membrane, obviously, and there's the chloroplast. Okay, so when the stoma is open, the function is gas exchange and transpiration. When it's closed, obviously, we don't want that to happen. Leaf structure, make sure you know the different sections. All right. Now, in this one, I just added the functions. Every time when you look at the characteristics, how it is built, this is the function of plants. Photosynthesis, gas exchange, transport of the water, and that is then transpiration. That is what your plant every day. When you wake up, you have jobs to do, and every day this is the jobs of a plant to do these things. That is the function. That is why they are biologically important, if that is maybe the terms they used to ask you. All right. Now, they can also give you a picture looking like this. It's still the same thing. I'm just giving you more exposure. So there we have the waxy cuticle, epidermis, the palisade cells, the spongy cells, the gaps in between. These are just the cells that's cut in half. Okay. There we have the phloem and the xylem. Here we have the stoma and the guard cells. It shows you CO2 comes in, O2 comes out. Okay. All right. Now, the next part, the stem. Now, ladies and gents, please make sure that you will be able to identify the structure if it's a stem or if it's a root because your teachers are going to test you. All right. Now, immediately you will see there's lots of new words here that I haven't talked about. But actually, it's all the same the whole time. On the outside, epidermis. There we have sclerenchyma or colenchyma. It gives structure. It gives strength. There we have pith carenchyma. It's in the middle. Cortex, parenchyma. All of them is parenchyma. What is parenchyma doing? It is sometimes storing food and it's helping with photosynthesis. All right. Sclerenchyma, again, to give strength. Xylem in the middle. Phloem, just there. And cambium, that whole section there in the middle is the cambium tissue. When we look at it in color, it looks like that. So when we look at the stem, it will have a vascular bundle. Vascular meaning moving of fluids. Vascular tissue would be xylem and phloem. So vascular bundle is that section. That is your stem. Make sure you study the different parts. And always remember, there must be a heading. Heading, it's called a heading because your head is at the top. Okay? So when you draw a sketch, there must be a heading. Next one. The root. Here's the one with the root hairs. Immediately you can see the root hairs, ne? Same things. Epidermis on the outside. The root hairs you know about. Cortex parenchyma. It's green. Photosynthesizing, storing food. Endodermis on the inside and the pericycle. Now, xylem and phloem is in the X shape. We say that the pericycle, the xylem and the phloem, is the stelae, so that we get only in the root. Okay? So make sure you know what is the labels for a root, what is the labels for a stem. Now, looking at the root, people, it is very important that you know what is the road that water travels when it comes in through the root. Look, here's a root with different root hairs, and then we took just that one section, made it bigger so that you can understand. Color-coded so that you can understand the different sections. These are soil particles. Obviously, I expect that section around it to be water, liquid, moisture. Okay, that is a specialized cell. It's a root hair cell. But this whole section is the epidermis because it's on the outside. The next green section, as you will remember, green is parenchyma, cortex, photosynthesizing the cells. Then we have the endodermis. Then we have the pericycle. And there's the xylem. You can see it looks like a road. Something is moving. So all the water will go up towards the plant. So that is when you have to explain what is the uptake of water, you will say that water is absorbed from the soil, water and dissolved nutrients. It goes through the epidermis, through the root hair cell, through the parenchyma cortex, through the endodermis, the pericycle, and into the xylem, where it's transported to all the different parts of the cell. That is your root hair. All right. Now, we've been talking about the different sections of the plant, how the plant looks for its functions. Okay, now let's look at the functions. Just again, so that you can see, here's the root with the root hairs. The water goes up, like we just explained. It goes, now there's several different things that make it go up. You can talk about that depending on how much your teacher went into detail. We have different kinds of what is the word I'm looking for? There's pull and there's forces, different kinds of forces that's going to take it up in the plant. You see it goes into the leaves everywhere. And when there's too much water, some of the water vapor will go out. Water evaporates from leaves. That is transpiration. So very, very important, transpiration. Okay? There's certain things that's going to influence how much a plant is going to transpire. Transpire meaning losing water vapor from the different parts of the plant. So all of the leaves are going to lose water when we have transpiration. Now, what is going to influence the amount of water that a plant is losing? That is very important. Make a note in your brain. The size of the leaf. The bigger the leaf, the more water is going to evaporate, or water vapor. Orientation means where on the plant is it located and how is it moving, how is it orientating itself. And the shape, like I said previously, the leaves can roll themselves up to prevent water loss. Okay, the stomata you know about already. The cuticle you know about. The thicker the cuticle, less water will evaporate. And then obviously, if there's gas exchange and the stoma is open, obviously we will lose water vapor as well. Okay? The environmental factors around, environment is most now around us. So what is going to influence how much water the plant is losing? And that is the environmental factors, either losing or how much water the plant is taking in. The temperature, the humidity. When there's lots of water around the plant, moisture in the air, it won't need a lot of water, okay? Unless there's not a lot of water in the plant, then we're going to have movement. And then when the wind blows, it's also going to influence the situation. All right, water uptake in a plant. Then here we get to transpiration. This process is very, very, very important. The whole plant is built in this specific way so that it can transpire if it's necessary. Okay, so please keep in mind when you think about a definition for transpiration, that is water loss in a plant, and very important, transpiration is not losing water, it's losing water vapor, but we will get to that. All right. Very important, your teacher can ask you, what's the difference between transpiration, wilting, and guttation? Now, immediately when I look at this plant, it makes me think of you guys. This is like in period one, and then after break, you look like this, and then the last period, normally you look like this plant. You totally wasted, ne? So, let's have a look. What is transpiration? Losing water vapor. Wilting of a plant is like this, when you obviously need water. We will look at that now again. So the amount of water in the soil that the plant has is now not enough. Obviously, this plant needs a little bit of water. So wilting is when the plant is losing water due to transpiration maybe, or not enough water that is available. Okay, now that is not a problem. That is basic things. The difficult thing that you don't understand sometimes is guttation. Now look at this. It looks as if there's water drops on top of the leaf, but just in specific places. Now those are specific cells where that is happening, and you will see it only in those areas, and we call that guttation. Guttation is when a plant loses water. But transpiration is when a plant is losing water vapor. So just a short summary for you here that you need to focus on. Guttation occurs during the night. Transpiration occurs during the day. Guttation is water that is lost and it has minerals. Transpiration is just water and it's water vapor. And here they tell you, in guttation, the water is lost as a liquid. Transpiration, the water is lost in the form of water vapor. Please, for yourself, make sure that you know what is the difference between transpiration, wilting, and guttation. They will ask you, and then at least you will know. All right. Now we get to the experiments. Now, I'm sure, I hope you would have seen this, the pitometer. This is a device that we use to measure the effect of transpiration. Now, when you look here at the top, you will see I said effect of dot, dot, dot on transpiration rate. It's because we can investigate the effect of temperature on the transpiration rate. If it's hot outside, will the plant transpire more? Will it increase or will it decrease? Light intensity, the effect of light on transpiration rate. Will more light make the plant photosynthesize more? Will more light make the plant transpire more? The same with wind and the same with humidity. So that's the four factors that will have an influence on the transpiration rate. And then this is the device that you use in the class to measure. There you can see, there we have a plant inside this reservoir where there's water. There we have a ruler so that we can measure the movement of the air bubble. That is a tube, and there we have a beaker of water. So as the plant is taking up water, so obviously this water will be sucked into the plant, and then this bubble will move. Now, depending on how fast the bubble moves, or if it even moves, we can check what is the effect of these different things on transpiration. Okay, so make sure you do understand the different experiments and you are able to answer questions. Now let's have a look what is important, because when we have experiments, we will have graphs. All right, now normally when we have a graph, I'm not talking about a pie chart. A pie chart is a different story. A pie chart I will handle more when we talk to grade 12s and grade 11s. But this is our basic graph. We can have a line graph, a histogram, All different kinds of bar graphs, etc. But when you have a graph, there must always be a heading. And the heading is made up of what you have on the x-axis and what you have on the y-axis. So this horizontal line is your x-axis and this vertical line is your y-axis. And then, very important, always and forever, on the x-axis, we have the independent variable. If you don't know that, or if you keep on forgetting that, you must go and write it down for yourself until you can remember. Independent variable is the variable that we always put on the x-axis. And dependent variable is the one that we always put on the y-axis. I sometimes say to the children, independent variable is the one that I can control. I can decide, am I going to measure this every minute, every hour, every day, every month? So independent variable is the one that I can decide. And dependent variable, that is the result. That is what I want to measure. That is what I want to see, what is happening. If I change this, what is happening there? Okay, so this is the one I can control, and this is the one that I'm measuring. And if you don't know these terms or it makes you confused, you'll have to go and study them. It's very important. And I say again, the heading will be whatever is here on the x-axis and whatever is here on the y-axis must be mentioned in your heading. The heading must have the independent and the dependent variable. Don't make a summary of the heading because you are lazy. If you summarize your heading, we're going to summarize your mark. Let's have a look. Heading, type of graph, labels, plotting. That's the basic things that we look at when we are marking your graph. So your heading, if your heading contains independent and dependent variable, yes, you get a mark. Type of graph, if we ask for a line graph and it's a line graph, even if it's wrong, you can still get that mark. So sometimes if you get confused or you didn't study, like some of you do, then you just draw the graph and you draw a line graph, then you must get at least a mark for type. But it would be really nice if you at least know what you are doing. Okay, so label with the units. Let's say, for instance, this is time. You can't just say time, you must say in minutes, in hours, or whatever the case may be. The same year, there must be a unit. If you don't have a unit, we don't give you marks. All right, so mark there. Sometimes that's one, sometimes it's two, it depends. Plotting means if you now draw your graph and you plot, for instance, I must say now that is the first plotting. Every time that your plotting is correct, you get a mark. If you have some of them wrong, you get one mark. If you have all of them perfect, you will get full marks. So that is how we look at this, all right? Also, the other thing that I see that is a problem is scale, ladies and gents. Use your ruler, which I don't have, but let's do it. Use your ruler, okay? And on your ruler, depending on what you are drawing, you use your ruler to give you the same space the whole time. You can use the millimeters there or you can use the centimeters here. And then every time it's the same width from one another. Work accurately like this, okay? So that you have that and zero starts here. You must have your heading at the top. You must have your independent variable and your dependent variable there. And then when, for instance, let's say 5, 10, 15, 20, okay? If you get a table and in the table they say, okay, let's start at 0, 3, 7, 8, 11. That's the numbers they give you. You guys must go and you just fill in 0, 3, 7, 8, 11 and then you think you shana na, okay? You can't do that. Let's say, for instance, this is now the one that we must draw. Then I also can't work on 5, 10, 15, and 20 because all of my graph will be here in the middle. So I must decide when that is my graph, a better option may be to work in threes or twos even. Okay, so instead of having that, I can say, oh, no, no, that is not great. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. That distance that we have there must be the same the whole time. And the difference between this number and that number, that difference in between, must be constant. It must be the same the whole time. You can't just pick and choose it as you want. So decide on your scale before you start drawing your graph, and then you will have the correct distance and scale like they ask of us. Okay? Very important something, the heading must not have the units, and the heading must be underlined, okay? And like I said, what is on both axes must be part of the heading, okay? And then labels, remember the units, okay? Then when we look at investigations, you will always in your test, exam, whatever, you will always have investigations where they give you a situation, an experiment, and they ask you questions about it. Okay. Now, one of the things that they can ask you is investigative question. Now, ladies and gents, a question will always have a question mark. Okay. So if I have a hypothesis is a statement. I see something happening, I make a statement about it, and then I do the experiment. I'm investigating. Okay. So I see something. If plants are placed on a windowsill, then plants will grow towards light. So my hypothesis is, when plants is on the windowsill, they will grow towards light. What is my aim? My aim is, what am I going to investigate? To investigate if plants on a windowsill grow towards light. Okay? So your aim will always be like to investigate, to determine, to see. That will always be your aim, okay? And your aim can also give you a guide of what is your heading, all right? Because what you are going to investigate, many times they ask you to draw a graph about it, all right? And then another thing, when they say, draw a graph to investigate or to determine, and then the rest of that sentence, many times the graph that they ask you to draw, that is also the heading that you can find in your question. If you can't find it in the question, then you go back to your experiment and you look at your aim and the hypothesis. Then you will find it there. Very important. Dependent variable is the growth of the plant. Because when I put the plant on the windowsill, what is going to happen? The plant is going to get light and the plant is going to grow. What am I measuring? I'm measuring the amount of growth. I want to see if the plant grows. What am I controlling? The amount of light that the plant is getting. So when I have a graph here, the amount of light will be here, and the amount of growth will be there. And in my heading, I will mention both of them there. Okay? Fixed variables, very important. If I want this experiment to be valid, to be true, for anybody else to be able to prove it, I must use the same size pot, the same amount of water, the same amount of soil, etc. So those things that must stay the same, they make this experiment valid and they help us to prove it. So the moment they ask us what must stay the same or what is valid, make this experiment valid, we look at these things that they will mention in your experiment. Now, very important, ladies and gents, there's something that they always ask in an investigative section, okay, investigation. They will ask you, what will make this experiment reliable? Meaning that when you do it anywhere else in the world, you should get the same result. Now, we will have an experiment will be reliable when you increase the sample size. Increasing the sample size means, instead of just using 2 people, I'm using 50 people or 500 people. So the more people I use and I get the same result, the more reliable my result is, okay? Then what I also do is repeat the experiment. I don't know if it happens once, maybe I'm lucky. If it happens the whole time or repeatedly, then I know that my experiment is reliable. And then something else that you can do is you can, the results that you get, you can divide and you can get a number, and that also helps it to be reliable. Okay, sometimes they give you the function. For instance, they will say, instead of using just 5 people, we are now using 500 people. What is the effect on the experiment? Then you can say it makes the experiment more reliable. That is the word that we want, reliability. Okay. But ladies and gents, we are not finished with the work, and now we get to things that you like more. The human skeleton. And this is like, you look like that to me sometimes in the class. Okay, as if you are a skeleton. There's nothing left. You are empty. You are tired. Okay. Now, the ATPs changed a lot of the syllabus for us, so we are not going into a lot of depth. If you are interested, by all means, you can go and read more and study more. But the basic things that you need to know about the skeleton is the following stuff. Okay. I don't know if you can see this properly. It looks as if the paper is a little bit glossy. Okay. So the human skeleton is divided in two basic main parts. Okay. The first one that we have here, you can see it's the head and the chest section, or the thorax, like we say. It means that is the axis, that is the base, axial skeleton. That is why we call it the axial skeleton, the axis that everything is attached to. That is the skull section, the spine, and the ribs, the chest. Okay? Then the other one is the appendicular skeleton. Now, appendicular, the word makes me think of appendix. And when you have a bunch of papers or they add something, they say, look at appendix A or appendix C. They've added something to the paper. So this part of the skeleton is added to the axis, to the basic one. So everything that's added onto this one, it's connected there and connected there. It's the appendicular skeleton. So that's the arms and the legs and the hips. All right. Now let's look at it closer. The different sections that you must be able to name. Okay. The axial skeleton is made up out of the skull and the different bones of the skull. And then obviously the spine and the different vertebrae in the vertebral column. Okay. Here we have the chest section, the thoracic cage. There we have the sternum, and we have the ribs that's attached to the sternum. And here you will see some of the floating ribs as well. Now, immediately when you look at this structure of the chest, you can see it is surrounding this area that's inside. So everything that's inside is protected by this thoracic cage. All right? That is the axial skeleton. You have to study this. It's plain and simple study work. All right. Then let's look at the bones of the skull. We have lots of names in different sections. You just need to know that this section is the facial bones, the bones that's in your face, that's the facial bones. The bones that's around your brain, the cranial bones. And as you can see, it looks as if there is a cracked area, that is just the sutures, because when you are born, your skull is not fused yet. When we look at your skull, then we can determine your age as well, because the older you get, the more fused it becomes. All right? The next thing, very important for grade 12. If you look at your skull and you turn it upside down like here, there you can see the teeth, that is the front part of your skull. Here is a gap, and that gap is called the foramen magnum. And that is very important for the section of your brain. Your brain is now here. Here you can see the cerebellum. The cerebrum that's underneath this section of the skull, you can't see. This is the bone section. It's behind it. So the cerebellum is connected to, not the cerebellum itself, but this part of your brain is connected with the medulla to the spine. And for that section to come through and connect with the spine, we need an opening like that. We need the foramen magnum. So you need to know about that opening for later grades. All right? Now, the appendicular skeleton are those sections that's attached to the axial skeleton. And here we can see the pelvis, the pelvic girdle. There we have the shoulder girdle, the scapula that's at the back. Here we have the different bones of the arm. And here we have the different bones of the leg. And all of that is part of the appendicular skeleton. That's the two main parts. They can ask you if they give you a bone. This is part of which part of the skeleton? Appendicular or axial? So you have to go and study. And now this is the section that you most like. Here we have, we almost have those skeletons hanging around, né? The different parts, the different bones. So, yes, you have to study the words. It's always good to know it, all right? The skull, for instance, the vertebrae. We know that it's a ball and socket joint, if you maybe handled the sockets. This section of the arm we call the humerus. Please go and study that. And then this front part of the arm, there's two bones. The one is the radius and the other one is the ulna. Okay? And then the small bones of the hand and the feet, tarsi and carpals. The femur is the big bone that you have here. There we have your knee and that is the patella. There's a bone there. And then the tibia and the fibula is the bones that we get in the bottom part of your leg. Okay, so that's the main parts, if you can make sure you know them. And then the functions of the skeletons, ladies and gents, obviously, it is protection. That's the first one. It protects everything that's on the inside. Okay, your heart, your lungs, and your other organs that's here inside. And then obviously the brain. Okay. Then the smallest bones in your body, just look at them. They are the bones that you find in your ear. So the other function of your skeleton is to hear. And you will do that in grade 12, where you look at the different bones that we get in your ear. They are minute, very, very small, and they help you to hear. All right? And then they say that your bones produces blood cells. So inside the bone marrow, the blood cells can be produced. That's another function. Inside your bones, we store minerals. And when you need the minerals, they can be taken out of your bones. And that's why we start to have teeth that is porous and we have bones that is porous, osteoporosis and all kinds of things like that. When your granny falls, she breaks a hip or a bone easily, all because of this. Then, obviously, the skeleton is helping us to move. We looked at tendons and ligaments, the bone that's attached to the bone by them, and then obviously the muscle that's attached to the bone and the ligament. So that helps with the movement. And then lastly, when you look at this, the whole skeleton is supporting the body. It's helping you. So those are the functions that you need to mention. And ladies and gents, don't always summarize the answer. Give us an A and a B section in your answer. Just make it a nice long sentence. All right. Long bones. That's the other thing. Long bones. There's two long bones in your body. The first one is the humerus. That's in the arm. You can see the arm here. Okay. Then they also show you, look at all of the small bones in your fingers. We call them carpals. There's different sections. And when you fall, you sometimes break your wrist here or there here in your forearm still when you're growing up. There is the humerus. The humerus is the long bone. You can see it's in some people, it's exceptionally long. You can see that. Okay. This is the leg. We also have a long bone in your leg, in the femur, this one. And then here we have the tibia and the fibula, and there obviously the tarsals, the different foot bones. It's complex. You just need to know that the femur and the humerus is a long bone. And then this is how it looks. There's again a skeleton, long bone, long bone. Your teacher can ask you to draw the long bone or to label it. Now there's a lot of different labels here. Okay, but these labels are the ones that is prescribed. So the head of the long bone, there's the head section, here's the head section. Where's the spongy bone? You can see those bones, the part of the bone that looks as if it has holes, it looks like a sponge. That is the spongy bone. The marrow cavity you will find on the inside of the bone, and that is where blood cells can be made. Compact bone, look at the bone there, there's not a lot of holes. And then the shaft is this section in between the two heads. So it all depends on what your teacher wants you to know, but that is the basics. All right. And then the section that everybody always waits for in grade 10, they can't wait to talk about the heart, the transport system in your body, the circulatory system. All right. Now, First of all, the heart you find here in your chest, behind the sternum, it's protected by the rib cage. Your lungs obviously will also be here. And then when you look, you see your heart, there's sort of it goes to the left side. The apex, the point of the heart is towards the left side, okay? And then the heart itself, it has a membrane around it to prevent it from, you know, too much friction. So all of those things you can also go and have a look at. It all depends on what extra detail your teacher wants to tell you. According to the ATPs, the first thing that you need to know is that we as humans have a closed blood system. It means that everything is inside arteries, capillaries, and veins. When it's pumped from the heart, it goes through arteries, or it comes back through the veins. It's not just going into the cells as it wants. It goes into the capillaries and there the diffusion takes place. So it's a closed system. That's the first thing you must know. Then, second thing, we have a double circulatory system, meaning one, two. We have the pulmonary circulation. Now, the moment we hear pulmonary, it is lungs. So we have a circulation system that's going to the lungs. That's the lungs. But people, your lungs are not sitting there. They are actually next, close to your heart. This is just to describe what is happening here. So when we talk about lungs, it is pulmonary. You will see when we talk about the artery and the vein that's going to the lungs, it's the pulmonary artery and pulmonary vein. That refers to lungs. Then all of the rest is in the systemic circulation. So that's the system, that's the rest of the body. Two types, one big circulation to the lungs, because obviously you get your oxygen coming in from the lungs and the CO2 going out through the lungs, okay? And then the systemic circulation to get the oxygen-rich blood. Always when it's in red color, it's the oxygen-rich blood with the glucose that's going to the capillaries. And here the diffusion takes place so that the cells in your body can get the glucose and the oxygen. And then the waste products and the CO2-rich blood comes back into your heart. It's pumped into the lungs, the CO2, so that you can breathe it out. Okay. Now, what do you need to know about the pulmonary circulation and the systemic circulation? Okay. Very important that you know the different parts of the heart, okay, in order to understand this situation. So let's have a look. External section. You will also see that it's colored in blue and in red. Now, red is where we have the oxygen-rich or oxygenated blood, or the CO2-rich or deoxygenated blood, okay? So here they show you the superior vena cava. Superior meaning that you are better than somebody else. So it's as if you are above somebody else. So this is the vena cava that is above, that is at the top. Inferior vena cava, inferior if it's like you are smaller, you are below somebody. So inferior vena cava is the one at the bottom. All right. And then we have the different parts of the heart, which we will look at now in the next slide. That is the aorta, with the different parts there. Aorta is the big, big, big one that's carrying a lot of blood to the rest of the body and the brain. And here we have the pulmonary arteries and pulmonary veins, which is going to the lung. This one is bringing all the CO2-rich blood from the bottom part of the body, and this one is bringing all the CO2-rich blood from the top part of the body. On the outside of the heart, there's obviously also arteries and veins, because the muscle tissue of your heart, it also needs oxygen, and it also needs food. So sometimes when you hear people had a heart attack, and they're now getting a bypass surgery, okay, sometimes it means that maybe there's a clogging or an obstacle in the artery, and then the blood isn't flowing to the heart and the heart muscle is not getting the oxygen and the glucose, so it can't contract and work. Then the doctor will do a bypass. They will bypass the block if they can't fix it, or put a stent in it. They call that a bypass operation. All right, now, internal structure, ladies and gents, although it's quite interesting, it's again study, study, study work. All right. So when you look at the heart, there's four rooms, four chambers. And always the first room that you can come into, that's why it starts with an A, is the atrium. Then the atrium will go into the ventricle. Ventricle is V, it's later in the alphabet. So the atrium is first and then it's the ventricle. On the right side of your heart, and also atrium and ventricle on the left side of your heart. Now, very important. When I look at this pink section, that's the heart muscle. You can see that this section is much thicker than that section. It's because this section of your heart must pump the oxygen-rich blood through the aorta to all the parts of the body. And your body is big, so it needs a strong muscle. That's why it's thicker. This one is pumping the deoxygenated blood to your lungs. So the lungs are not far, they are close to the heart. So that's why this muscle is not as thick as the other one. It's not going to go far, but this side needs to pump to your whole body. All right, so I say again, when you look at the arrows, and this is just before the next section, so this is where we stop. The detail and so on is in week 10 that you are not writing your test about. So just make sure that you know all the blood that is coming from the body, CO2 from the superior vena cava, it comes into the right atrium here. From the inferior vena cava, it comes in here. Okay, and then we have valves. The valves are preventing the blood from flowing back. When it's pumped into the ventricle, we don't want blood to leak back there. We want to get rid of the CO2 rich blood. And this valve is called the tricuspid. Now the word cuspid means flap, okay? And the word tri means there's three flaps. You can't see it here, but there's three flaps, all right, on this side. On this side of the body, we have the mitral valve, or they also call it the bicuspid. Now, bicycle, two cuspid flaps. So this one has two flaps. And what happens here is that the oxygen-rich blood comes in from the lungs. It is pumped to the left ventricle, and then the bicuspid valve must close, and then it's pumped into the aorta. And again, here we have what we call semilunar valve, semi, half, and lunar is moon, and that is, they look half like moons. All right, this one is a semilunar valve, and that one is a semilunar valve. So, very, very important. Make sure this part of the heart, CO2 blood, that part of the heart, oxygen. I'm going to do this. CO2, okay. Then the CO2 rich blood, it goes to the lungs, okay, both lungs, to get rid of them. And then the aorta, it needs to take all of the oxygen rich blood to the rest of the body. Okay, please make sure that you can name all of this, make sure you understand how it works, and then in week 10, your teacher will describe to you the different stages and the contractions and all the other detail that you need to know. Okay, ladies and gents, that is now the theory. Just quick, I know we've been busy a long time. I just want to show you how to approach your question paper. Okay. Normally, the question paper will look like this. I'll just take it out here. Okay, if it comes from the department, it will have the department's badge on it, otherwise your school. This is an old exam paper, but you will start with multiple choice questions like this. Each question will count 2 marks. When you do this, please read properly what they want, because sometimes it's confusing. Like here they say, not correct, okay? The leaf structure is adapted in various ways to reduce water loss. We don't want to lose water. Which statement regarding these adaptations is not correct? Okay, so then you will have options A, B, C, and D. And if there's an option immediately that you know is not correct, like this one, epidermal hairs are present. We don't have hairs that is losing water. The hairs is taking the water up. So immediately you can scratch that out. Now you have to choose between the rest. Okay, then What they talk about, the cuticle is shiny. Yes, the cuticle is waxy and shiny, so that should be correct. And the lamina, when you look at the leaf, that big section, the blade or the lamina, that surface is reduced. When that surface is reduced, yes, we will have less water loss. And then the thickness of the cuticle is reduced. If we make it thick, then we will struggle to lose water. Okay. The thickness is reduced, meaning then it's thin. Then we're going to lose water easily. So your answer is C. And then you write it down next to 1.1.1. You don't write the answer. You write A, B, C, or D. And just one. We'd only want one answer. Okay. Another way that they ask it sometimes, it looks like this, where they give you options and then you have to choose the combination. Now, don't even look at that combination at first. Okay. You just ignore that at first. You look at the question. Which of the following are found in the upper limb? Now, if you know your different parts, you will know that radius and ulna, that's part of the arm, scapula is the shoulder, tibia is in the leg. So those things are not correct. So I'm looking for I or 1, and I'm looking for number 4. So now I check. Where do I have I and where do I have number 4? So the answer is C. Don't let this situation confuse you, please. All right. Ladies and gents, then we have a picture. They ask you which statement is true about the neuron, and then you're going to go through it. Like I say again, we don't have a lot of time, but you can, this that is not correct, you scratch out immediately. Okay. It gives support. No. Transmit impulses through the body? Yes. It serves as connective tissue? No. It forms part of epithelium tissue? No. So the answer is B. Immediately take out the things that you don't know. And if you don't know an answer, don't sit here the whole time. Make a note for yourself and come back to it later. All right. Then you will have either the terminology or fit column A to B. Now, when you fill in this one, 1.2.1 to 1.2.3, they tell you there, you must write A only, B only, both A or B or none. So you can't just answer what you wish. If you decide, for instance, let's do this one, 1.2.2, unicellular, one cell, finger-like outgrowth from a plant organ. What is that? That is a root hair. So the answer is B. So you say it is B only. Okay, so all of them work like that. Make sure you understand the process. Okay, then we look at different terms. And here it is very important that you use words and you use terms. You must use the correct term. That is what it is all about. Okay, for instance, let's have a look. The first one, a type of connective tissue that exists in liquid form. Now, we have there cartilage, tendon, ligaments, and then blood. And blood is the one that is in liquid form, so your answer is blood. Most of the time, these questions are definitions, if you are lucky. Otherwise, you just need to read properly and then give us the term. Okay, this question is about skeletons. All right, so first of all, you look at the picture when you get a question with a picture. If you can identify things, you do it already. Here we see it's a crab with a hard exoskeleton that looks like an earthworm that's going to be soft. So they ask you, name the two types of skeletons. Obviously, exoskeleton and hydrostatic skeleton. Then they will say, state two disadvantages. Almost I make the same mistake as you. Disadvantages. What is the disadvantages of having a strong, fixed skeleton like that? Okay, things like it limits the body size. It needs to be shed. When this crab grows, it must get rid of the hard shells and they must mold. They must get new shells. And while they are doing that, they're going to be vulnerable for predators. Okay, so we start with a basic question and then the question becomes more difficult. All right? This one, you know by now, very, very important. Please, when you get a sketch like this, label it first before you even look at the questions. Okay, because sometimes the questions confuse you. We have the waxy cuticle, epidermis, pellicide mesophyll, spongy mesophyll, stomata. What's the three functions? We have transpiration that must take place. We have gas exchange that must take place. We must have photosynthesis. So the questions will be around all about this. Okay, there, for instance, I see cell types B and C. B is epidermal cells, C is pellicide mesophyll cells. Name the one process that occurs in the stoma. We have gas exchange and we have transpiration. So it's one of the two. This one, very important. How is C structurally adapted for photosynthesis? Remember, we talked about the shape. It has this shape to channel the sunlight through so that photosynthesis can take place in the chloroplasts. It has many chloroplasts for this to take place. It's close to the epidermis, so the light can reach it quickly. And then the cellular spaces in between is much smaller because the gas exchange happens here. All right. Then the last one here, draw a label diagram of a God cell. Now, very important, ladies and gents, always a heading or a caption, like they sometimes say. Then you draw your picture. You give 1, 2, 3 labels, okay? And mostly that is how it works. Your heading or your caption is 1 mark. Your drawing is 1 mark. And then we will look at 2 headings. So make sure you know what it is. The vacuole, the nucleus, the God cell. Remember, this is the God cell and this is the stoma. Okay, so remember all those different things. You can't just draw a picture. All right, here we have it. Now, this is the experiment I talked about, the investigative question. You will always have that. Here you have a table. They say draw a line graph to show the results of the investigation. So now you don't know what is the heading. Then you go back to the section where they write something. There's nothing there at the top. Let's just look. That is just the question. So it must be here. Set up to investigate water loss from a leafy shoot. Okay, so we have water loss, but what's the rest? And when you read all of this, you will see on the inside and the outside. So when I have to draw this on a graph, time is the one that I control because I decided when we're going to measure. So time in minutes will be here. It will be my independent variable. What are we measuring? We are measuring the change in the mass or the water loss, and that happened in grams. So that's my dependent variable. And then you will draw your graph and you will have your heading and you will have your scale correct, and that is how you get your experiment. Okay, then your whole paper will just be about this. Okay, you will not have an essay question like the others had in the past. It will just be shorter questions. Okay, the skeleton. I will give you questions about the skeleton. Identify the different parts. Is it part of the axial or appendicular? Why are you saying that? You can have questions. And here's the one I want to show you. They have the root, because we have root hairs. They have the stem here. And now they're going to ask you questions about them. Which one is the root? Why do you say it's the root? Because there's root hairs because of the X or the cross shape of the vascular tissue. Xylem tissue supports the plant. Motivate this statement. So you can say the xylem, for instance, it has thicker cell walls. It's a long tube so that it can channel. It has lignin in the corner, so it makes it stronger. Okay, it's a narrow cavity so that the water come up. So everything, every time, why is it built like this? To do its job. So every time you look at something, you must say, it looks like this because it's doing this job. All right. The same questions over and over. This one still has a question 4. We don't have a question 4 anymore in life sciences. But look, what is the difference between guttation and transpiration? What is the 3 environmental factors? So maybe we don't have an essay question anymore, but teachers can still ask you shorter sort of describe questions. What is the difference between guttation and transpiration? Could be one question on its own and it can count 4 marks. Or what is the 3 environmental factors and how will it increase the rate of transpiration? So you mention the 3 factors and you explain it, so that can count 6 marks, ladies and gents. So there we go, a little bit of practice in the question paper. At long last, I'm sure you are tired, ladies and gents, but luckily you can stop the video and come back to the stuff that you don't know. And please, grade 10s, I know it's now sort of a new thing, because in grade 8 and 9, your NS or natural science may not be so compacted or full of work like grade 10, and everything is new, the pace that the people are working at and what they expect of you. But hang in there, make sure you know the basics, and the only way you will know is by sitting and by studying. So good luck.